Hi, I'm Megan. Today we're going to get to know our anesthesia machine. Just a couple things that I want to go over. The first being the equipment that you're going to use for your patient, and that is going to involve your reservoir bag and your anesthetic circuit. So first, choose your anesthetic circuit. This one that we have currently hooked up to the machine is an adult circuit. Here I have pediatric. And then we also have what's called a non-rebreather. Pediatric circuit is usually between 5 and 15 pounds of body weight. Anytime you're gonna get less than 5 pounds, you definitely wanna move to a non-rebreather. Some really old, small patients, you may want to move to a non-rebreather. What that means is that every breath the patient takes with a non-rebreathing circuit is fresh oxygen, fresh gas that they're breathing. So they're not rebreathing anything that they previously exhaled. Once you move on to this type of circuit, this is a pediatric circuit, so anything less than 15 pounds. An adult circuit is going to be anything more than 15 pounds of lean body weight. With these circuits, the animal is going to be rebreathing a portion of what they exhale. When you're deciding whether or not to use a non-rebreathing circuit, it's not necessarily based solely on the patient's body weight. You really want to watch the anesthesia machine. If this patient is so debilitated, so small, so weak, that they're not able to actually move air through the circuit, move these little valves back and forth, move the reservoir bag, then you know that that patient needs to be on a non-rebreathing circuit. So we're kind of forcing air into them a little bit. They don't have to work very hard because the fresh gas, fresh oxygen is right here at the port, as opposed to them trying to move through this entire circuit. Once you choose your circuit, you then need to choose the size of reservoir bag. The reservoir bag is very important. It is used as a reservoir, so there should be some air that's in this bag all the time, but the animals should be moving the bag open and closed when they breathe. The reservoir bag you choose based on the patient's weight, and you're going to do 6 times their tidal volume. So tidal volume is 10 to 15 mils per kig. So you're going to go 60 to 90 mils per kig round up. That's going to be the size of your reservoir bag. So if you're having problems with the reservoir bag, if it seems too full, just go to the next size up. If it seems empty all the time, move to the next size down. But if you do that little bit of math beforehand, you should be able to choose the right size bag. This is our pop-off valve here. This is a really important piece of the anesthesia machine. Here at DLEAH, we do have this safety button here. If I push this button down, it's like closing the pop-off valve, and I can squeeze the bag and give my patient a breath. But as soon as I remove my hand, the pop-off valve is open again. If you don't have this safety valve, you're going to screw down to close the pop-off valve and then give your patient a breath. Always, always, always unscrew the pop-off valve to open things up again. So if at all possible, keep your fingers on the pop-off valve at all times, especially if you close it. Don't move your hand until it's open again. If this pop-off valve is closed, your reservoir bag is going to expand. It's going to increase the intrathoracic pressure, the pressure inside your patient's lungs, and you can cause significant trauma and possibly death to your patient if the pop-off valve is left closed. I want to move over here to the oxygen side of the machine. And a lot of people just turn oxygen on to 2 liters a minute and run their patient under anesthesia at 2 liters a minute. There is a math equation that you can do. The needs of your patient, as far as oxygen flow rate goes, is 25 to 50 mils per kg per minute. So you don't want to go below 500 mils per minute. So once your oxygen flow rate drops below half a liter, you're really going to have problems with the concentration of your gas being exactly what you think it is. So at least 500, but most patients can probably run at less than 2 liters of oxygen per minute, so 25 to 50. If you want to do high flow oxygen flow rate, that is 2 to 300 mils per kg per minute. So I like to do that at the beginning of anesthesia. The higher your oxygen flow rate is, the faster you're going to be able to fill your anesthetic circuit with your gas, and the faster you're going to be able to get your patient under that gas anesthetic. So if you use, for example, propofol to induce anesthesia, propofol is metabolized and wears off quickly in your animal, And if you don't quite get them under gas anesthesia quick enough, you can have a really rough transition from injectable to inhaled anesthesia. If you induce with propofol, turn your animal on high flow oxygen for the first 10 minutes of anesthesia, so 200 to 300 mils per kg per minute, let that gas anesthesia kind of saturate your system, saturate your patient, then you're gonna have a much more smooth transition to fully inhaled anesthesia. So turn them up for the first 10 to 15 minutes and then back them off to that 25 to 50 mils per kg per minute on your oxygen flow rate and maintain your anesthesia from there. I want to mention the oxygen flush valve. There's a little bit of controversy about whether or not you should use this when it's hooked up to a patient, what that does. Basically, when you push the flush valve, you are flooding the system with pure oxygen. When you push the flush valve, it kind of bypasses your vaporizer, so you're not getting any gas into that patient. You're only going to use that if the animal needs straight oxygen without any gas. You never, never want to use the oxygen flush valve if your patient is on a non-rebreathing system. You can definitely increase the pressure way too quickly and cause significant trauma. You can use the flush valve if you need to on a larger patient that's hooked up to one of these anesthesia circuits. You just want to be careful of how much pressure is in your reservoir bag. You want to watch your pressure manometer and make sure that you're not putting too much pressure into that animal's lungs. But if you have, for an example, an emergency situation, you can push the flush valve, bypass your vaporizer, and give fresh oxygen to your patient. The times that you're going to have to do that should be minimal. So really, it's not something that you should be doing all the time with your animal, but you can do that if you need to. So this is the vaporizer part of the machine. This is where the liquid anesthetic is then turned into a gas for the patient to inhale. Here we use isoflurane. Sevoflurane is another popular gas anesthetic. You do, before you perform a procedure, just want to check the level of your gas. It's important not to overfill. It's important to make sure that you have enough for the procedure that you're going to be doing. These are called precision vaporizers, so you can set them to a very specific rate for your patient. You want to be very careful with your vaporizer. Make sure that if you have your anesthetic machine and you're moving it around, that you don't bang it on the edge of a table. If the machine tips over, all of this is going to change what your vaporizer is doing, so make sure that you take close care of it and that you do have it inspected on a regular basis to make sure that it's actually delivering what you think it's delivering. Lastly, I want to talk about our CO2 system here. We are using these CO2 absorbing granules. The point of these is the air that the animal exhales kind of passes through these. The CO2 is absorbed by these granules. It's important that you change these every 8 hours of use. So we just keep track on the side of the machine how long it was in use, and then every 8 hours of anesthesia time, just dump out the granules and change them. They will change to a purple color when they've been exhausted. However, if you don't notice them change, they will change back to white eventually. So you don't trust the color change alone. Brand new fresh granules will be kind of crumbly in your hand. Granules that have been exhausted are going to be much more hard and tough, so you can test them that way. But the best way to do it is just keep track of how much you're using your machine. Every 8 hours, change it out. Those are the basics of your anesthesia machine.
One veterinary website with everything you need. Check it out on atdove.org.